In this video, we'll use the simple move command to move this carriage from one end of the slide to the other and back again using button presses. We'll also take a look at how position limits and sensor limits work and what the difference is between absolute and relative positioning. We'll cover S-curves using jerk and registration in separate videos. In this demo, we have a Productivity 2000 with an HSO module. The HSO module sends pulses to a stepper drive, which controls a stepper motor to move the carriage up and down a slide. We have two push buttons wired to the HSO inputs, and we'll use those to control the action of the slide. We also have two proximity sensors wired to two more HSO inputs, which we'll use for hard position limits. I've already selected a CPU, gone into the hardware configuration, and auto-discovered the hardware and configured it. Here's how everything is set up for this demo. Check out the HSO configuration video if you need a refresher on how to configure all of this. Well, since we've already set up the hardware, all we have to do now is write the ladder code. We'll use the forward button that was defined in the hardware configuration that I did before we started this video to enable a simple move command. We want to use the channel that was also defined in that hardware configuration. Let's use absolute addressing, and rather than filling in all these blanks, I'm simply going to say I want to use a structure and call that structure forward. We'll cover jerk in a separate video so we can spend some time understanding exactly what this is and how to use it. We want the carriage to stop immediately if there's an error, or if we terminate the move early. And we'll cover registration in a separate video on the registration command. We'll fill in the values for position and velocity and acceleration, etc. in the data view. Now, could we have put static values in if we wanted to? Sure, but we would have to turn off the structure mode to do that, and we would be stuck with those values. We wouldn't be able to change them in the program. We can add comments to the rung, which I would normally do. I like lots of comments. But since we're so limited on screen real estate in these videos, we'll skip that so we can get more ladder code on the screen. I'm going to exit the simple move command just so I can modify the tags we just created. We'll want our position, velocity, and acceleration tags to be floats so we can use fractional numbers. Now that the tags are all defined the way we want them, we go back into the simple move command so we can add all of these tags to a data view. This saves me so much time. I don't have to create my own data view. The productivity suite does it for me. For the reverse direction, it's the exact same thing, except we want to control that direction with the reverse button we defined back in the HSO configuration and create a new structure that we'll call reverse. And of course, don't forget to modify these tags so we can use fractional numbers, and then go back in and add those tags to the same data view as the forward direction data view so we can watch the forward and reverse processes at the same time. We also want to be able to force the HSO module's channel position to zero. Since the module keeps track of the position from the time it's turned on, the only way to reset the position is with the set position command. We just tell it to set the position to zero when this instruction is enabled, and we'll enable it with a contact that we'll control from the data view since I don't have any more buttons connected. Great. Let's download this to the processor and give it a try. I'm going to reach over and flip the switch to put the CPU in run mode and bring up a data view. I've already deleted the stuff that we don't need and rearranged things a little bit, so don't be surprised if mine looks different than yours. I'm also going to add the positive and negative direction limit tags, which we defined in the hardware configuration, so we can modify those. We have a 24-inch slide, so let's make our positive direction limit 23 inches and a negative direction limit 1 inch. We want to move to 20 inches in the positive direction at a max rate of 15 inches per second, and we'll accelerate and decelerate at twice that rate. For the reverse direction, we'll target 2 inches as our destination, and we'll use the same velocity and acceleration as the positive direction. Let's also add the carriage zero contact and the real-time position and velocity tags to our data view. We'll do homing in a separate video, so for this demo, we'll stop the CPU and just manually move the carriage to zero using the high-speed module testing tool. Now we put the processor back in run mode and toggle this contact to set that carriage position to zero. There's a whole video on how to use that test tool if you want to learn more about that. Now, putting the processor in stop mode cleared all of our tags, so let's write those back to the processor. If I press the forward button, the carriage ramps up the velocity, moves down the slide, decelerates, and lands right at the 20-inch mark we specified. If we hold down the reverse button, same thing, ramps up to speed, heads down the slide, and ramps down and stops at the 2 inches we specified. Now, what happens if I push the forward button but let go before it finishes the move? Well, look, the motion stops immediately. Why? Because we told it to. You can see that over here. If we had checked this button, then it would have decelerated to a stop at the max rate specified in the hardware setup. Now, I don't like holding the button down, so let's seal this contact with an in progress bit. Now the button will start the command, but the in progress bit will keep it running. We call that sealing a contact. Let's do the same thing for the reverse direction and send that down to the controller. Let's turn on monitoring so we can see the status of the contacts. Notice that we don't need to update the tags because we did a runtime transfer. And sure enough, if I temporarily push the button, that contact turns on and back off, but the in progress bit keeps the command running to completion. Perfect. What happens if we tell the carriage to go outside of the range limits that we set? Our slide is 24 inches long, and we had specified a position limit of 23 inches. So let's move that position limit out to 30 inches, way beyond the end of the slide. And let's specify a target distance of 29 inches, again, way beyond the end of the slide. When we hit the forward button, the carriage stops abruptly before hitting the end of the slide. Why? Because I added some proximity sensors to the slide to act as hard limits to detect end of travel using this adjustable sliding tab. We defined those inputs here in the hardware configuration and then enabled them here for this channel. These are true physical limit switches read directly by the high-speed module's inputs. These limits down here are programmable limits, which are best used for those times when you need to programmatically set up temporary limits. And as we saw before, the carriage stopped immediately because the move instruction told it to. We could have told it to ramp down at the maximum acceleration rate if we wanted to. Now, while we're here, let's enable this relative move in the forward direction only, and send that down to the controller and see what it does. Let's modify the forward target distance to be 5 inches. And while we're at it, we'll get the position limit back in bounds from that change that we made in the last example. The reverse direction is still absolute, so let's send the carriage back to the absolute 2-inch mark. Now, when I push the forward button, the carriage moves 5 inches away. If I push the button again, it moves another 5 inches. Push it again, another 5 inches. So in relative mode, we're not going to the absolute 5-inch mark on the slide, we're moving 5 inches away from where we were. That's a relative 5 inches. Well, that's all for this video. We'll cover S-curves using jerk and registration in separate videos. Also, be sure to check out this video on how to use these status words to debug your motion application. That'll save you a lot of time. If you need any help, please contact Automation Direct's free, award-winning support team during regular business hours. They'll be happy to help. And don't forget the forums. There are lots of folks there that love to share their years of experience. Just don't post any questions for Automation Direct's support team there. They don't monitor the forums on a regular basis.